Well, the weather is actually pretty nice this weekend. Today's my Friday off, so I got the correct length bolts for my main landing gear, and I came out to test fit my instrument panel. And while I've been whining about the weather not being warm enough that I can do the Oratex process outdoors, I looked at the forecast for the next several days, and it does not drop below 45 degrees. Typically around 50, I'm good to go. I'll be covering my wings starting tomorrow. The other fun thing, not directly related to the build, but it's kind of motivational, reached out to Michael Garber, who does artist renderings of various people's airplanes and boats, and looks like other stuff too. I'll put a link down in the description below. I gave Michael a challenge because normally you're sending him a picture of your completed aircraft and he makes the artist rendering. In this case, there's a long way to go and I'm trying to get some idea what my paint job's gonna look like. I had one idea I sent to him. He kind of expanded on it. I think it came out pretty good. Let me know what you think. That way the radial engine kind of threw him for a loop. It's a little bit harder than just a smooth cowl, and especially if you already have an example of a cowl that exists. So I had to send him pictures of the engine and my fake rendering that I've thrown up before with the radial I borrowed, scammed, from the Verner website. Anyway, so it's on there. As I mentioned, today's Friday. I've still got Saturday and Sunday ahead of me. I'm gonna come out tomorrow. I'm gonna finish cutting those tubes, crimp them at the right angle, drill them, get them mounted up with those Adele clamps on those forward sections. And then wheel that thing back in here and I will be at home working on the wing covering. What you're looking at here is my instrument panel. I'm calling it a mock-up because my intent is to have one of these CNC cut and have the engraving done, but I know that there's going to be some changes. In fact, there's already been a couple. So this is just the Kitfox part number. I cut out the rectangle cutouts, drilled holes. This matches my SolidWorks CAD model. I'll show a picture right here. These are my MGL MX1 displays. I did intend to do circuit breakers here, but I've changed my mind already. And then, of course, the SolidWorks CAD model, put them back and forth here so you can see them, but I do have engraving. This is my starter button. This would be my, what would be your magnetos if you had those, but this will just be, in my case, front and rear spark plugs and fill pumps 1 and 2, battery master, avionics master, and alternator in some order. So these are the lighting switches. This would be like landing light, position lights, strobes. And this was a panel light, and then I had the dimmer here. This dimmer is actually an on-off switch. So I could ditch this switch and just use the dimmer. So again, one of the changes there, ELT panel. And getting back to this, so after some research and getting a hold of this book from B&C, I've decided that I am going to use one of those automotive style fuse blocks with the blade fuses for a number of reasons. First of all, these are expensive. That's not the deal breaker necessarily, but back when I was a student pilot, I was taught that if a circuit breaker pops, you can push it in one time. If it pops again, you don't touch it anymore. The FAA and many aircraft manufacturers don't feel pilots should be troubleshooting an aircraft. That's also Bob Knuckles' opinion. I actually was going to use the klaxon type breakers here, which are the ones you can pull. There are the other type, which sit flush. You can't pull them out. Those are commonly found in your Cessnas, Pipers, etc. And then there are fuse holders, which my Satabri had, where you can undo the cap and pull out the glass tube type automotive fuses. Those aren't very efficient. Again, learned that in here. So those blade type are more efficient, also cheaper, readily available. And Bob's point is that you design the system so that it's robust enough that you're not blowing fuses. And if you do, there is no fixing it easily on the side of the road or at a runway. These switches, I obtained all of these through B&C. These, I have pointed out in a previous episode, these switch guards are actually replicas of the ones found on the Space Shuttle eBay acquisition. The other pieces, which I just dug up yesterday out of my kit, these are the various grommets, which are used to provide some kind of rubber isolation. So this smaller rubber grommet goes in the hole in the bottom, and then the rest of it gets sandwiched around the welded on tabs that are in the fuselage. This thin material is meant to create some L brackets so that you can put a Tinnerman nut and have a place to put the glare shield screwed in. And then these heavier duty angles are meant to go on the opposite side. I've only got one hand here. To stiffen up the panel, this would have been for a typical center stack where there's radios to help you build up an avionics rack. And lastly, I don't know if they do it differently now, where they just use aluminum tube and squish them, but I did find these two. They're pretty sure they're 4130. They're actually weldments with a squished end, and these are meant to go on the other side. Keep in mind, I have a Kitfox 5. It does show them at two different lengths and has a page in the manual which shows their location. They actually connect to the top hole on that aluminum angle. You know, me, I'm a weight freak. These things seem a little bit heavy to me. I do have plenty of aluminum tube, which I can squish the ends and bend them. I'm going to mock up both those. I will put this instrument panel in the airplane, verify that everything's where I want it. You'll notice my throttle, mixture control, etc. are not on here. I am going to do like a lot of people with a sub panel down below so that those don't have to be disturbed to pull the panel out. And yes, you can see I did a terrible job of cutting this rectangle cutout. There's an air gap. If these MX1 displays have something I'd like to see different, it's that the bezel is, the overlap of your cutout edge is almost nothing, so that has to be cut carefully. And that's why I'm a big fan of going with the CNC route. At any rate, so some of this stuff may change once I get it in the airplane. And then the other thing I'm going to do is mount this upright, put it on a wooden base, and I can wire up the backside. And at some point when I do have the new panel created, then I'll just be able to take everything off here, put it on the new panel, be good to go. What I'm probably going to do is, now that these holes are not going to be used, I'm going to go with the automotive style fuse block. I've seen where some people put them accessible underneath the panel. Could do that, a little bit more gymnastics, or I may put a door on the front of here, and so the door is removable and the panel would be accessible behind there. Got some more toys. I was just at the aviation trade show here in the state of Washington last weekend and ordered a set of these. These are, used to know them as Whelan, these WAT. These are the Blaze lights. I just got this about 5 minutes ago. These are my strobe and position lights, including a white light to the rear. Note of caution, as is mentioned on my build thread on the forum, these are not TSO'd lights, and if you dig through the regulations, TSO lights are required to be legal for night flight, even VFR. So these are not legal for night flight. I don't intend to do a whole lot of night flying. The representative from Whelan assured me that these are brighter than legacy lights, but he said if you do plan to night fly, you should go with the Orion series, which are double the money. And they're quite a bit wider too. I like these because they're super light for one, and that these will be easy to adapt to my Horner style wingtips. The other thing I recently obtained was, this is a strip of LED lights in red. I will put this along the underside, the lip of the glare shield that sticks over, and that's what's going to be on this dimmer switch. Again, not setting it up for night flight, but could potentially be ready. It's still way too cold to be working on the wings, so I'm back on the instrument panel and did a real quick test fit in the airplane the other day. I did not have these L brackets in place yet, and so I just had to set up some clamps and temporarily put in position, but it fit. I had some footage where I showed these steel tubes, which do have part numbers in the Kitfox 5 manual, and I was correct. In the Kitfox 7 manual, it just says you use some aluminum tube. As it turns out, the shorter of the two is actually too short to do the job anyway. So I decided to get out the aluminum tubing. This is the 3/8 diameter 035 wall. I squeezed one end. And in the manual, it has you a riveting. It does tell you to use flush rivets. I think flush pop rivets. So this is the first time in my whole life I've done flush rivets. And I can tell you that doing them on the instrument panel that you're going to stare at the rest of your life, and it's probably not the place to learn how to do these. So I got some practice. Then I had to use some 632 screws up on top. These are way too long. And then it implies that these flanges, these on these weldments, will go on there. And it's not really the case. Kind of tight. So what I'm going to probably do is I've got a hole on the side here. And I'm going to attach this. The angle on this hasn't been completely decided yet. I'm going to take my Arbor Press to the airport with me, and some Adele clamps and some hardware I have coming to set up all that. The other thing I did was ordered a hinge, full length, because I'm trying to figure out a way so I can make the panel so it tilts out for maintenance. Finally made it out here this weekend to put in the correct bolts. Last weekend I drilled the holes that are required for getting the gear in the right place. It's all custom made. To start the process, you get a bolt through this point right here. This bracket is floating. Get you a view of this right here. The holes for this hole and that one need to be drilled. So I was trying to get it all rigged square, and of course the airplane's, nothing's perfect about it. Got it within an eighth of an inch. Before I drilled the holes, my son was out here and he suggested that we actually triangulate from the tail post and get the wheels square to the inside of those axle tubes. And we did that. We got it within an eighth of an inch, and then I shifted side to side to get this perfect, or as close as I could get it. Everything's within an eighth of an inch anyway, so went ahead and drilled those holes up. So I had some bolts, they were the wrong ones, but I got that fixed, got the right ones going. And then you can see I've got my instrument panel out here. This is my mock-up. I have it mounted with the, didn't sock these down, they're just the nylock bolts, but they're in place, everything lines up. Elsewhere I have the reference, the aluminum tubes. I have the just some hardware store hardware holding that in. And then I got these Adele clamps in the mail today, aircraft space order. These are 5/8 tubes and I didn't have the right size, so now I need to mark them, cut them, squish them so that they're the appropriate angle so they match up with that. I still do have to come up with a mount for my throttle and mixture control. And I also mentioned that I got a piece of hinge that I was hoping to be able to set it up so I could unbolt those two tubes and rotate the instrument panel out of the way. The hinge I got the wrong size, so that's not gonna happen this time around, but that's why we test fit. Anyway, step back here a little bit. You can get an idea what this landing gear looks like on the plane. It's everything I was hoping for. Now I need to pull it off, clean it super carefully, primer and paint, which will be red. All right, well, I'm temporarily between airplanes taking off and landing, so came out just a little while ago, marked these, trimmed them, squished them, drilled a hole, deburred everything, and got these 5/8 Adele clamps in here. And I was just test fitting my boot cowl just to make sure I have plenty of room. And I do. So these could actually, I could shorten these a couple inches if I needed to, as long as they stay, you know, below this X and by a couple inches. I did have a suggestion from somebody on Facebook, not sure if you're gonna be able to see this, to ditch the nuts and washers and use nut plates here. That's probably a good suggestion. And this is all causing me to think I should get out my glare shield and trim it now. The other thing I'm doing today is I got some scales. Read that one, 104.2. Nothing scientific about this because there's miscellaneous boxes and crap and a few tools, but give me an idea. 105.6. And 57.9. Now, you have to level the airplane to get a decent center of gravity, but just summing up the three numbers gives me the overall weight of the airplane so far. I'll have to add those up in my head when I've got more fingers available. So I've done enough damage here. I think I'm gonna head home, start covering. It's gonna be raining here pretty soon anyway. Time to pack this up, tuck this thing back in the hangar. Back home now so I can get started on those wings. I remembered that I do have some touch up to do. The joint where the two liquor leading edge sections come together. There's a few angles that when I view them, it's not quite even. I know that would annoy me forever. So I've got a long sanding bar that I used to use on model airplanes. I'm gonna clean that up. So once all those pieces are fared in and the primer's touched up, I will be getting into the application of the Oratex adhesive. And I think I've got plenty for an episode here. I should stop real quick and thank my sponsors.
So follow me for tips and tricks on how you too can pay full retail. I'm just messing around. This channel is not monetized. It's probably never going to be. Anything I say about a product is because I believe in it. So apologies for any advertisements that you might have to endure watching any of these videos. I didn't put them in there. I don't have any control over them. So anyway, thanks for watching. We'll see you on episode 23.